Hello YouTube, and welcome to Heathen Hacks.
Well, that Red Dead Day finally came, ladies and gents. After more than 6 years of service, one of my VZ239HR monitor, which I reviewed last 2018, eventually succumbed to old age and have started doing this. Half of the screen is malfunctioning now. It seems to have the same backlight issue as my 10-year-old TN panel from AOC. Quite unfortunate, because I even posted an update video about them last July 2023, stating that they're still working as expected, only for one of them to wave goodbye a year later. Having no other choice aside from switching back to a dual monitor setup, which I highly detested, I've decided to buy a new pair of monitors, not just for replacement but also as an upgrade, because this time I specifically looked for one with the base amount, more screen real estate, and a higher refresh rate. After about 3 days of research comparing prices, specifications, warranties, and availability, I've come to the conclusion that the ROG Strix SG27ACS 27-inch 1440p 180Hz G-Sync compatible monitor from ASUS is the right choice for me. But more on that later. Let's go! All the accessories included are conveniently inside this ROG pouch. We have the power cable, ROG branded DisplayPort cable, probably just from an OEM, some ROG stickers, warranty card, and the quick start guide. The box looks like this. It's too big though, so it wouldn't fit my desk. Here we have the stand. Ooh, this is quite heavy. At the back of it, we have an ROG logo. It has a built-in cable management pass-through, 120mm of height adjust, 90 degrees pivot on both sides, negative 5 degrees forward and 20 degrees backward tilt, and 45 degrees swivel on both sides. Here we have the base with its embedded markings for precise monitor swivel orientation, a built-in phone holder,
for some reason,
another ROG branding, and a tool-less captive screw for easy installation and disassembly. Okay, let me just wear these gloves before we take out the monitor. Now, you may or may not notice that there are some fingerprints on the screen already, and that's because I prefer to test them both for dead pixels or other defects inside the store. In terms of I/O, it has a 3.5mm audio jack for headphones or a speaker, a USB-C port for DisplayPort out mode that allows USB-C to transmit DisplayPort video signals from desktop PCs, mobile phones, laptops, or other devices. According to the specs, the USB-C port's power delivery is 7.5 watts. It is definitely enough to charge mobile phones, but it would be quite slow. As seen here, at 7.6 watts with a 0.1 watt difference, my phone is charging, but just normally because it uses a 25 watts power brick for super fast charging. Here is the DisplayPort 1.4's, well, port, HDMI, and the one for AC power. At the back of it, we have the control panel. This is the navigation nipple, or if you ask Urban Dictionary, a click mouse. It's a 5-way key for up, down, left, right, and click or confirmation operations. You can use it to easily traverse the settings with just one key. Key 1 is for closing or exiting the OSD. Keys 2 and 3 are programmable hotkeys, and by default, they are set to Game Visual and Game Plus, which we would take a look at later. We also have a power button for turning the monitor on or off. It has an LED indicator that lights up with white when it's turned on, amber or orange when on standby mode, and off when turned off. Another ROG branding, and this one right here, ease of assembly. You just need to hook the stand to the panel like this and it's already attached. If you want to remove the stand, you just need to press this quick release button right here, and there you go. Also, here is the 100mm by 100mm base mount. Alright, let's attach the base, tighten it up, and we Gucci! Right, I almost forgot to mention that there's a built-in tripod mount on this monitor stand. It accepts screws that are 1/4 inch in diameter, so you can mount pretty much anything on it as long as you have the right screw size, and of course, if it's not literally heavier than the monitor itself. Now that it's fully assembled, it's time to connect it to the computer. The power cable would be connected to my UPS, while the DisplayPort cable would be connected to my GPU. Moving on to the monitor's dimensions, it has 614.81 mm or 24.20 inches in width, 267.08 mm or 14.45 inches in length, and 218.82 mm or 8.61 inches in depth with the stand included. If you need more dimension information, they are available on the user manual, which you can download from ASUS website. Just for comparison, here is the old VZ239HR 23-inch monitor. As you can see, the panel is significantly thinner when compared to the XG27ACS. The XG27ACS's panel is almost two VZ239HR panels thick when stacked together. When first starting up, we are greeted by this power setting notification to decide on whether to use power saving or standard mode. Do take note that enabling power saving mode would disable all the other settings and would restrict the brightness to 45 or lower. As you can see here, all the other settings are grayed out, but once we set it to standard mode, the restrictions would be lifted. As for the stock settings, it's set to racing mode on game visual, display port for input, HDR is off, 2560x1440 resolution, and is already set to 180Hz refresh rate, which is good. Here are the other settings in their current configurations. Under gaming settings, variable OD or overdrive is set to 10, variable refresh rate or VRR is set to on. Inside ELMB setup, we have ELMB and ELMB sync. You can visit ASUS FAQ right here if you want to know more about ELMB and ELMB sync. Inside Game Plus, we have the FPS counter, crosshair, timer, stopwatch, and display alignment set to off. On Game Visual, as mentioned earlier, we have Racing Mode set as the default, and Shadow Boost is set to off. Moving on to Image Settings, Brightness is set to 65, Contrast 80, Vivid Pixel 50, HDR off, ASER or ASUS Smart Contrast Ratio is disabled, Aspect Control to 16:9, Full, Fill Up, and Blue Light Filter is also set to off. Onto the color settings, by default, display color space is set to wide gamut, color temperature to 6500K or Kelvin, saturation to 50, 6-axis saturation to these values, and gamma to 2.2. On input selects, auto input detection is enabled by default, which is good. My favorite setting is where you can set keys 2 and 3 shortcuts, and by default, key 2 is set to Game Plus and key 3 is set to Game Visual. Let's move on to the default system setup. Language is set to English, sound is set to mute, power indicator is turned on, power key lock and key lock settings are turned off, power setting is set to standard mode since we have set it to be on standard mode earlier, OSD or on-screen display setup is set to these values, and DisplayPort stream is set to 1.4. Here's the monitor information. Model name, XG27ACS, color depth is 10bpc or 10 bits per channel, format is RGB444, EOTF or electro-optical transfer function is disabled because HDR is also disabled, VRR is supported, and lastly, firmware version is MCM101. Now, I'm not going to elaborate on it, but these are my current settings. According to ASUS, Game Plus is a tool co-developed with input from pro gamers that allows you to practice and improve your gaming skills. It has 5 features, namely FPS counter, crosshair, timer, stopwatch, and display alignment. To test the Game Plus functions, I've loaded Rise of the Tomb Raider,
the game that I'm currently playing,
and here are my game settings. This is the FPS counter. It has 2 modes, number, which just displays the FPS number, and bar graph, which displays a bar graph besides the number. It's located at the top left of the monitor. As you can see, the FPS counter is stuck at 180fps, while Steam's FPS counter displays around 90. I'm not sure if I just set it up wrong, but the most likely reason is that it doesn't work on Linux. Not a big deal though. It's kind of an eyesore since it's too big. Both its color and position are non-configurable,
as far as I know,
and Steam has its own FPS counter anyway. Moving on to crosshairs, it has 7 modes. Dynamic, which uses the dot style, crosshair style, and the slightly bigger crosshair style. It's called the dynamic crosshair because as you can see, it changes color depending on what it can see in the background to make the player distinguish the crosshair better. If dynamic crosshairs aren't your thing, you can also pick the ones with solid colors. And for that, we have the cyan and green for each kind. Dot style, crosshair style, and the other slightly bigger crosshair style in green and cyan colors. If we want to limit our gaming duration for whatever reason, we can also choose to display a timer that goes from 30 to 90 minutes or 1 hour and 30 minutes. And if we want to see how much time has passed since we started gaming, we can also use the stopwatch option. Unfortunately, they are yet another set of non-configurable features,
as far as I know,
that are displayed on the top left of the monitor. And lastly for Game Plus, the alignment function, which I will not touch since it's perfect out of the box. Moving on to Game Visual. According to ASUS, it is a screen color management tool that provides a variety of screen color scenarios to bring players the best personal visual experience. It has 9 different color scenarios or modes, and as you can see here, on the stock settings, Game Visual is set to racing mode. Let's go over what each mode looks like, starting with scenery, racing, cinema, RTS or RPG, FPS, sRGB, MOBA, night vision, and user mode. Here are some samples of what it looks like on different viewing angles. Do keep in mind that what's demonstrated here does not directly reflect what I see myself, since the camera kind of overcompensates how bright or dark some scenes are, and in return, exaggerates the monitor's backlight bleed, which is not that much to be honest. It's only visible when you look for it. I bought them last August 21, 2024, have been daily driving them for more than 9 months now, and so far, I'm enjoying every bit of it. Turns out, what the internet people said was true. Switching to a monitor with more than 60Hz of refresh rate is genuinely life-changing. I mean, I still suck at games, but it really does feel that way. Everything is buttery smooth even with my ancient RTX 2070, and not just that. It made me appreciate PC gaming even more. Frame pacing just hits different, and everything from simple desktop use to fast-paced gameplay is much more fluid and responsive. Going for a pair of monitors that are slightly bigger than my old ones was definitely the right call. The added screen real estate makes games and movies feel more immersive, and it also makes a huge difference for productivity, especially when I'm editing videos or working on multiple windows side by side. I originally considered going with 32-inch monitors or maybe even an ultra-wide, but due to space constraints, I ended up with two 27-inch monitors instead. Honestly, no regrets. As someone who makes a lot of tutorial videos, the built-in tripod mount is definitely one of my favorite features because it's really useful for top-down shots. It also has both an adjustable stand and a VESA mount option, which are great to have. I'm currently just using the default stand, and since it's height, tilt, and swivel adjustable, getting both monitors perfectly aligned was quick and painless. And since it doesn't have an external power brick, it uses a standard power cable instead, which means replacements are cheap and easy if it ever breaks. And in terms of software-related features, I honestly don't use most of them. I don't use Game Plus at all, and on Game Visual, I just stick with user mode. I have never used HDR2, so I can't really comment on that experience.
Also,
according to Asus, they have a software called Display Widget Center where you can change your monitor settings easily via software. In conclusion, depending on your needs and budget, there are other solid and possibly cheaper alternatives out there, such as the AOC Q37G4, MSI G274QPFQD, Gigabyte G527QA, and probably more. I chose this one from Asus because it's a relatively new release, which means longer software and warranty support, it's within my budget, and I wanted something reliable that wouldn't get phased out too soon. Plus, the design and features checked all the right boxes for me. Thanks for watching, and see you again next week. Maybe.